the reason we have this field trip is that I want to introduce you to the geology of the Cincinnati area. I want you to get a feeling for what the rocks are in this region, what the landscape is like, and what the geologic hazards are in this area. So the idea of this field trip, and the field trip on Friday, is to give us a tour across Cincinnati, looking at the major landscapes and the major geology. And what I want you to do is to fill out this sheet, and I'll send you a nice copy of this via email. And this sheet has a series of maps on it, so I want you to follow the maps and find out where you are in each of these locations. I also want you to take GPS locations at every stop that we're on this field trip and on Friday, okay? And then you're going to plot that on Google Maps, or you'll have a Google Earth when you get back. And this is called Trammell Fossil Park. It's named after the very generous people that donated this area so people could look at the geology, the bedrock geology of Cincinnati. So what are the rocks that are underneath our feet here in Cincinnati? Anybody remember? How do you know that? Because I told you. Well, now you're going to look and you're going to see for yourself what the rocks are. So I want you to describe the rocks. We've got thin bands of shale and thin bands of limestone. We call the bands beds. And I want you to see what's in them. And Cincinnati is very famous for these rocks. These rocks are Ordovician in age. What geologic period are we in now? Quaternary. We're in the Quaternary. Well, the Ordovician was a period about 400 million years ago. The rocks are about 435 million years old. So they're really old. And the rocks contain lots of fossils. And the group of rocks here, the succession of rocks, is called the Cincinnatian, named after Cincinnati, obviously. And people from all around the world come here to look at the fossils because they're very rich in fossils of Ordovician age. And this is the type area for the Ordovician fossils in North America. So people come here and study it. We have a lot of paleontologists in our department who are interested in these fossils. So I want you to look and see what types of fossils there are. And these boards illustrate the different types of fossils. And each of the layers are broken down into subunits and they're given names. And you see the names on it. We don't need to worry about the names. Just remember, they're Ordovician and they belong to the Cincinnatian. Okay? So that's the first thing. You can see what the rocks are. Why do we have rocks here? Why do we see the rocks? Landslide. Well, it could be a landslide, but have a look around. What else exposed you? Sorry? Glaciers? Not really. Erosion. Sorry, erosion. Yeah, erosion. Erosion. What type of erosion? Wind and rain. But what? Look behind here. You can see the steep slopes. What's caused the steep slopes there?
Buildings.
Buildings. Humans. So humans have cut these back somewhat. But if you look behind us, if you look out here, can you see that there are steep slopes all around? And if you look at the horizon, is the horizon hilly? No, it's not hilly. It's flat. It's flat, isn't it? Look, it's flat. Look how flat that is. And if we look at this thing here, okay? So we're up here. We're up on this area. So all this sort of red is this flat horizon that you see. And then we have these big valleys. And you see there's a big valley going down there. That's this valley. And it's going down to the Ohio River. It's the Mill Creek. And we're going to go down that in a minute. So what do we call these steep slopes that go down to the rivers? Know what we call them? Begins with a B. Bluffs. These look like little twigs. So if you get down on your hands and knees, not all the way down, and you look in the dirt here, you'll see look at these little things that look like twigs. These are bryozoans. See them? They just weather out, and then there's shells. These shells, nice little shell. Yeah, bryozoans. There's a shell, and then these are called brachiopods. So you've got these little things which basically like. They're not coral, they look somewhat like a coral. We're little creatures that live in little holes, they're called bryozoans. And we will find some corals as well. Corals have like little horns, like a little devil's horn. They're called horn corals. See all the shells? And if you just take this one thing here, just look at this, strip away. The rock is full of shells and bits of bryozoa. It's all built up of this rock. So these hard grey rocks are the limestones, and they're full of shells. So what do you think we might call these if they're full of shells? Shelly limestone.
Yeah.
It's a shelly limestone. It's not very thick.
What's that, about?
Mostly about 6 inches or so, a little less. And then, if you look at this stuff here, can you see underneath here, there's this muddy muck. Yeah? And on a wet day, this stuff would just be mud. And this is the shale. Can you see how I can break it with my fingers? And if I was to get some water, put water on that, it would become muddy and slushy. And so the harder limestones stick out, the shales are underneath and they're muddy. Most of what you're finding here are the little bryozoa, they're like little twigs, and these things called brachiopods. These are shells. Now, there's only a couple of brachiopods left today. There's one called Lingula, and the other one I think is called Terebratula. But in the past, and in the Ordovician, the oceans were full of these brachiopods, and what you see in these shelly beds, these limestone beds, are the accumulation of brachiopod shells that form the hard limestone and the bryozoans. And as you go around, you'll see there's lots of different names for these brachiopods, there's lots of different types. And they lived in shallow, warm waters. And a reconstruction of what this area was like during the Ordovician is shown on the board behind me. And you can see that we were just below the equator, and we've moved north over the equator. So we're in a tropical shallow sea, about 435 million years ago. So, okay. And these succession of rocks represent something like about 15 million years of time condensed into those rocks. The slope shale, what do we call this broken material that's on the slope? Anybody know what we call that? You remember we called it talus? Where you have a face, the material breaks down, and the stuff moves down the slope. We call it talus. But the landscape. Are we on a cliff? No, we're not on a cliff. We're on a flattish area. We say the area might be a little undulated. And if you remember from the drive we just had, we drove up a hill, up a bluff, onto a sort of flattish area where we drove through the neighbourhood, which is kind of rolling. Okay? And the location, the last location, was somewhat, maybe about 10, not quite that, maybe 5-6 kilometres that way, as the crow flies. Okay, and that was on a cliff, that was on a bluff. So we're up above the bluff, we're up on this undulating area. Yeah. So what we did was we drove down this road, there's a bit of a jump, we drove down Highway 42, and we drove up into this neighbourhood, and we're up here somewhere. I want you to also think about where we are in terms of Ohio. What type of map is this? I've given you this map. It's a digital elevation model, yeah. It's an elevation map. It's a digital elevation model. And I showed you this in class. This is of Ohio. And can you see these big sort of ridges? Do you remember what those ridges were? See those big ridges? What were they? Yeah, it was about where the glaciers were. We call them moraines. So the ice came down through Ohio. If you look at Ohio, it's got a large flat area up here, or flattish, low-lying area, of the Erie Lake Basin. Then we've got Appalachia over here. Then we've got the Ohio Valley. And we've got these lobes that go down across this highland area. Not as high as Appalachia, though. So the ice actually came down, and we're right at the limit of where the ice made it during the last glacial here. It was just maybe a kilometre up this way was the main ice front. Come and have a look. Come closer. What type of rock is this?
Granite.
Excellent. It's granite. Yeah. It's not like the rock we saw underneath us. So this rock's come from somewhere else. So we see a rock like this, different rock type, on top of the underlying bedrock. We call it an erratic. It was brought by the glacier. And this boulder was probably brought by the glacier. It probably wasn't dumped here. It was probably dumped somewhere else in a garden centre, picked it up and sold it to the Boy Scouts to put here. But as we go down this valley, I want you to look for rocks like this, ones that weren't purchased from a garden centre and put here as a little monument. You see, we have the glacial map. And we're just about one of these green, on the edge of one of these green lobes where the ice came. And in fact, in a previous glacial time, ice went all the way down to the Ohio on the campus. So what we find on top of the bedrock is deposits like this, and what we'll see down the valley in a minute. Here's our bedrock map. Remember, we talked about bedrock maps in class. The pink is the Ordovician rock, and as we go this way, the rocks get younger. So imagine the rocks all laid down in layers, and I said they were folded a little bit like this. Well, if we cut this line, a cross section through here, this is what the rocks look like. It's exaggerated somewhat, but in the core of this, we have the oldest rocks, which are down here. And as we go this way, if we follow this line, as we go this way, we go in younger and younger rocks. We go into rocks of the Carboniferous age. We'll climb down here. What are we in? What's the landform, the landscape we're in here? A valley. We're in a valley. Okay, good. That's pretty straightforward, isn't it? And if you look up, you've got the flat tops. So a stream is cut down through the valley here. Okay, what's the rock? What's all this rock that you see in the valley bottom here? What is this grey stuff?
Well, it's not clay, no.
It's the hard stuff. What's this hard stuff? Limestone. Just this limestone that you saw at the last location. Yeah? So the valley has been eroded into the limestone. But there's something else here. There's this stuff behind us.
Okay, oh, here's a piece.
Look at it. How would you describe that? It's gross, yeah? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
It is pretty gross, isn't it? You want to hold it?
Mm-mm.
No, it's too gross to hold.
Pretty small.
Pretty small, very fine, sort of muddy stuff. That's why it's gross. Okay, it's full of mud, but it's got little pebbles in it. And look behind us, it's got some big blocks in it. Have we seen anything like that at the last place?
Mm-hmm.
Not really, no. And this is what we call a diamict. A diamict is a sediment with lots of different grain sizes. Okay, and they can form by debris flows, or they can form by glaciers. In fact, this is a glacial diamond. So this has been formed, somebody dropped their sheet. This was formed because the glacier came across Canada, it ground up all the bits of rock into fine sort of silt and clay sized stuff, and it carried lumps of stone and some break. But what kind of rock do you think this is? That's the granite, isn't it? It's granite. And yeah.
Good, you're watching, excellent.
And this one, can you see that's got loads of scratches on it? See all the scratches?
Yeah.
And that's because the ice carried this, and it was probably at the base of the glacier, and it scraped along other rocks, scratching it. Look at that. See all the scratches? And these are what we call striations. They're glacial striations. So a geologist seeing this, say, wow, there was a glacier here. And about 20... something thousand years ago, maybe 24,000 years ago, there was ice just behind us here. And the sediment from the ice slurried down off the glacier and it buried trees. And in these glacial sediments, you sometimes find trees sticking out, fossil trees.
You'll see different sized fossil trees sticking out, sometimes the size of twigs, sometimes the size of logs this large. So right here, you guys see this? This is an example right here. So let's try to pull some of it out. There we go. And there she is. You guys want to pass that around?
And the landscape we see here has been fashioned by climate change, glaciation, and the processes associated with glaciation. Now there's a big time gap between the glacial sediments that are about the oldest here is probably a couple of hundred thousand years down in Cincinnati. The oldest glacial sediments are probably in the order of a couple of million. There's a huge time gap between a couple of million and the Ordovician, which is 430 million years ago. So all the rocks that were deposited, anything that went on above that was just scoured away, eroded away by rivers and by the glaciers. So how do we know it's 20-something thousand years? Chris, you pulled it out, so you passed it around next to me. How do we know it's that old?
Layers.
What do the layers tell us? How do we tell where the rock layers are?
There.
We actually tell the age by the fossil itself. So what would we use to find out how old that fossil was?
Carbon dating.
Tree rings? Well, if we had 24,000 tree rings, maybe, but it wouldn't. That would probably have about maybe 100.
Carbon dating.
Radiocarbon dating, yeah, radiocarbon. Landsliding. So how do we know it's landsliding? Well, the first obvious thing is there's no vegetation. Look, there's a scar up there. I see the scar goes round in almost a crescent form. We can see this block's actually displaced from up there. It's moved down. You'll see that the pew at the bottom here is is bulged out. Okay? You can see that there's no trees on there. There's lots of trees, the branches, the small branches, maybe. This thing has fallen over. You've lost the roots on that. So there's some landsliding. And the landsliding's taken place in the till deposits, in the glacial deposits, not in the bedrock here. And why is the landsliding taking place? What's caused it to fill? Sorry? The stream. Yeah, how has the stream done it? It's undercut, exactly. So the stream's undercut it, and it's caused the landslides. And actually, if you look behind us, there's like a little step with the trees on, and there's another step. And all this was filled in with sediment, probably up to about 100 or so years ago. And then things really started changing around here. People started to modify the landscape. We built houses. We've made impermeable surfaces. And so when it floods now, the flow rates are higher here, and they've eroded and caused these landslides. What I want you to look at is the slope across the highway there, across on the other side of 75. See the slope? And many of you have probably driven past this many times. And in the last 3 years, that slope has changed a lot as they've widened the freeway. And can you see all of the sort of gravel on the slope? Those gravel areas are where they've infilled landslides. There's huge troubles in trying to stabilize that slope. They dug out the landslides, they put gravel in, but then the gravel's moving out the slope. And that slope is built on glacial sediments. There's bedrock behind it, but there were glacial lake sediments there. And when you cut into lake sediments, you're cutting into very fine clays, and they have the tendency to slip. So it's one of the worst things to try and cut into and build a highway slope. Excellent, the Ohio River swung around down through here, carved in. The Ohio River is now to the south of us. When the big glacier came down, when it reached this far, it pushed the Ohio to its present position. And when it retreated back, the Ohio just kept draining that way and left this valley behind. And then these smaller streams strained. We call these little small streams misfit. They don't really fit, misfit streams. So first thing you notice, what do you notice about the horizon? Is it mountainous? No, it's flat like we saw the other day, yeah? It's not quite as high as the vegetation either side. And this was what was called an incline. And in Cincinnati, there were these trolley systems which allowed people to come from the low ground up to the high slope. And if you come over here, come over this way, it's where you need to be observant. Okay, so this is the Price Hill Incline, or where the Price Hill Incline was. This is what it looked like. Okay, so if you were working down, maybe it's sort of on the docks down here, on the side of the river, you wanted to come back up in the evening, you had a nice house up here on the top, away from all the smelly pigs and that were being brought in, then you'd use one of these things to get up the hill, to get up the bluffs, these steep bluffs. And so people in Cincinnati have lived in around this hilly area. We don't really tend to think of it as hilly, you know, it's not like sort of living somewhere like Seattle, but we do have these big bluffs to climb up. Okay, so you have to build on these bluffs. Now, we don't use these anymore because roads and everybody has got their cars. The very first location on Wednesday, from Trammell Fossil Park. And then we have this big valley. And what's the stream that drains through this valley? Remember what it's called? We saw it on the third location on Wednesday. Mill Creek, good, Mill Creek. Tiny little stream, but look how big the valley is. What's this river out here?
Ohio.
Ohio, of course, yeah. So that's a big river, and the Ohio ones flow down through here. The glaciers pushed it this way. But we've got to explain this flat surface. Why do we have this big flat surface?
Floodplain.
Sorry?
Floodplain.
It may have been rivers, actually, would have drained across this flat surface a long time ago, and they drained to the northwest, and eventually went into the Mississippi drainage. But the rocks here again are horizontal, or they're tilted very slightly into a fold. So the landscape, all the rocks are capping this, and the rivers would have drained to the north of the river, this way, to the northwest, and then gone to Mississippi. Then the Ice Age came. The big glaciers came down and pushed the draining rivers down into the current Ohio region. And the Ohio started to carve down through these layers of rocks. And it carved down these steep bluffs. And the Ohio would have carved down these steep bluffs. And then we have little steps. So if I take my little diagram, didn't draw it very well, but a little step here, and that little step is a place where the river would have cut down to another level. And then we have the lower steps, which are the floodplains of the Ohio today. And if you remember when we talked about flood, and I showed some pictures of all this area, downtown, all this region flooded by the Ohio. So what are the hazards we have here in Ohio? We have landslides, we have floods, what are the hazards? We have erosion too, where streams erode. Remember we saw erosion, which are undercut banks, caused landsliding at the glacial site. And if you look here at Mount Echo Park. Okay. And I want you to do the same thing here, have a look at the landscape. Okay. Before we do that though, you can see the big ferry down there. What's that carrying? You probably know what that's carrying. Limestone, it's limestone, yeah. And it's probably coming from one of the biggest limestone quarries in the US, which is over near Paducah in westernmost Kentucky. And that limestone is used for a variety of things. Does anybody know what we use limestone for? Why would we be taking loads of limestone? What do we make out of limestone? What's this stuff? Concrete. We make lime out of it. We heat it up and we make cement out of it. We mix it then with aggregates, like these little stones you see here. This gravel, this is some of the little bits of turf and stuff to make concrete. Limestone is also used in steel production, but my guess is that's probably going to make lime concrete. Or we can use lots of broken up limestone as part of the aggregate itself for things like making concrete for highways. So the Ohio River is actually it's the largest port in the U.S. You might not realize that. You probably thought sort of like New York or Los Angeles. But in fact, when you add up the whole length of the river as one massive great port, it's huge. And the Ohio River obviously has been very important for the development of Cincinnati. Cincinnati grew up around that. And of course, as a consequence of that, we live under the threat of flooding. So if you look down here, this is a town called Ludlow. And Ludlow is periodically flooded when the Ohio breaches its banks. By the way, the surface is a name. It's called the Lexington, after the city, the Lexington peneplain. Peneplain in geology means a plain that's been eroded down to an ultimate flat surface. So this is a very old surface that's been eroded down over many hundreds of millions of years. The Ordovician rocks are now over 400 million years old. So the rivers eroded that down and eroded across the landscape. And in 2.5 million years ago, we hit the Quaternary Ice Age, the Quaternary period. Big glaciers came down, pushed the Ohio into position. There's a little step from the river, and then we have a flat plain, and that's called a river terrace. It's a terrace of the river. The river periodically floods up onto that. So that's a river terrace. And Ludlow's built on the river terrace. Okay. This area.
Vegetation.
What about the vegetation?
There's lots of it.
There's lots of it, but something else about the vegetation. Look at the vegetation over there. Is there more vegetation over there?
Yeah.
It's, you're getting there, it's newer, you said.
Yeah,
where are the trees? You've lost a lot of the trees there.
Was there like a mudslide or something?
It's a landslide, yeah. It's a big landslide that slipped down here. And in fact, if you look at Google Earth, there's a little picture of looking back. If you were over there, can you see the landslide?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But these slopes are cutting back because of these landslides. So if you were to build a house, you wouldn't really want to build it up here, wouldn't you? Because eventually this slope's going to cut back. And you certainly wouldn't want to try and cut into this slope and build it down here. And you wouldn't want to be on the bottom of the slope. But look at all the houses on slopes up in Cincinnati. Over here there's not so many. They've built on the flat piece. In fact, they probably terraced that over there. But this is a big problem for houses around Cincinnati. And you walk down the hills from the campus, start looking at some of those houses. You'll see the walls sometimes are bowed out, sometimes they're a little bit there. You've got a little garden in front. What I want you to do here is to basically describe the landscape. So looking across here, what do you see? Trees. We're about, let's start, when we look at landscape, we start off by looking at things that are big. So what's the big thing here? Hills. What do we call those kind of hills? The bluffs, yeah. Okay, so we've got a river valley, and we've got these steep bluffs, and we've got that flat surface again. And we've driven a few miles along the edge of the bluff, and we've driven along this flat surface behind us. What's this flat surface behind us? It's all a similar thing as Ludlow was built on. River terrace. Okay, it's a river terrace. And periodically, the river will flood over this, so you could actually describe it as the floodplain to a certain extent. It's not a real good floodplain. It's more of a terrace because it's got an edge to it like this. So what are the hazards here? Flooding, obviously, yeah. Whatever hazard. Excellent, good. It's a beautiful landslide up there. So once you get your eye, you'll see them all over the place. And it's, you know, some of them are hidden away because of the dense vegetation, but you clear the vegetation a bit and you'll see the landslides. So landslides are a problem, so they'll flood in landslide. There's another hazard here, we'll see if I have it. Erosion, good. How do you know there's erosion here?
Yes.
Well, you're right, they've done something here to stop the erosion. What have they done to try and stop the erosion? They've got a bunch of rocks here, and actually they call these riprap. And you'll see it's all along the Ohio. There are blocks of stone. Some of them are huge. Some of them are a couple of meters in diameter. They're really expensive to put those big blocks on. But if it's somewhere very, very important, it needs protecting, you know, big blocks. Now, why are big blocks better than small blocks? Exactly, they don't get carried away. So if you get a big flood, you might move these. They'll get eroded underneath. Okay, so erosion's another problem. Let's walk down this way and have a look at something else. This way. Not the shell, no. It's actually a fine sand. There's a little bit of mud in it, but most of it's sand. Very fine. And that's what the river's carrying. Now when the river, look at the colour of the river. Is it nice and transparent?
Yes.
Yes, wow. Right. Yeah. So what's the other hazard here? Whatever gets put into the river. That's pretty amazing, yeah. That's a quite an amazing picture. You know what those are called? Anyone know what those are called?
Looks like
swordfish. I forget what they're called. No, that's not a carp. That was a long snout. Anyway, so there's lots of silt in the water there, but what gets deposited is the water flows here, and the coarser grains and a lot of the sand. But a finer silt will get carried up in the flood and dumped onto the floodplain. And as you go further down the river, the less sandy it gets. Okay? So the other problem we've got here is all this sand. It's a sedimentation problem. So it's mucky, it's nasty. Look at all the other muck that get carried in the river that's around us, these big logs. So why would these logs, floating trees, be a hazard? Boats, yeah, boats. Sure. So it's part of living along the floodplain. Stone can be eroded pretty easily, and it weathers because rain is acidic and it will dissolve the full caves. And if we go this way, we get into greater limestone country and some of the world's longest caves, like Mammoth Cave. Sometimes those caves, the roofs collapse and get sinkholes. Describe what the features here are that you see. So what do you see around here? Somebody start us off. Sorry?
A lot of concrete.
But let's look at the big feature. What's the big feature here? Bigger than the bridge. The river. South Bay, the river. Where's the valley walls? Yeah, they're way back there because we've got a stream coming in this way. We've got the Mill Creek coming in here. So here we have a much more extensive flat area than we had further up the valley. So when it floods, we've got a lot of area that could be flooded here. The next feature, next big feature, is the bridge. The one we stood on here. Concrete, but what's the concrete on? What's the landfall? There's a big rock. Terrace. And the four parts of water on the terrace. Huh? It's a big terrace, the river cuts down. And what did we walk through a moment ago?
A levee.
It's a wall, a flood wall. The levee's over there. That's the levee. And they've built a wall here, a flood wall. And if you noticed, I don't know if you did, but if you look back this way, can you see that there are slots in it? So when a flood water comes up, they put big metal sheets or big wooden planks in that to close up the hole, because obviously the wall will be of no use if there's a big hole like that. So the nice thing about this place is that when it floods, what type of flood do we get? Is it an upriver or downriver flood?
Yeah,
50% chance you got it wrong. Downriver flood. It's a downriver flood. Because all the water's coming from all these tributaries up in the headwaters of the Ohio, and the discharge gets greater and greater as we go down, the flood gets higher, which is good for us, because we can predict the level of flooding if we know what's happening up valley. And we can evacuate, we can close up the walls, the holes in the walls, to protect against the flooding. But as you saw from pictures in the class, clearly we do get big flood events. And they've engineered the walls along the Cincinnati side of the Ohio. And many of you have probably been down there, and in fact there's been sort of, often they have little fairs and things. And there's nice little steps you can sit on, which are all part of the flood protection. So when the water comes up, it washes in, it just washes out. We have this area to try and protect against it. You notice about the concrete down here. Come over and have a look. What's that? What's that concrete? So just looking at features like that, like I said, unless the guys are really bad, they really have time to use the ball before they... There's news about worrying about the infrastructure in the US, how old it is now, and all these, particularly bridges here. These have been here quite a while, 100 years, maybe not quite. And so, we worry about erosion, not the support. So hopefully they're designed not to erode away, but river will naturally erode anything in its way. So, I don't know how much longer these bridges have. And let's talk about replacing one of all of them in a couple of decades. See what happens on Tuesday, won't we? See. Yeah.